pick up any newspaper, watch cable news channels, surf internet news websites. It's all yesterday's news today. You need tomorrow's news today. You need Trends Vision 2020 now with Gerald Celente.
Welcome to the debut episode of Trend Vision 2020. I'm your host, Doug Grunther, in conversation with the publisher of the Trends Journal and leading trends expert, Gerald Celente. Gerald, let's get started.
All right, you got a boogie, man.
Well, I'm going to start.
I got to say boogie woman, too. I got to be politically correct. I just can't say boogie man anymore.
Gerald, what did the markets do today?
The markets. Over there in Asia, over there in Europe, everything's just kind of like mixed. Not a lot happening. Here's the headline. Dow falls for a second day on U.S.-China trade uncertainty. You know what that is.
Oh, come on now. That ain't even bullshit. That's horseshit.
It's horseshit. Every day, U.S.-China trade. There's no trade war going on. All of the tariffs that the United States puts on China equals 0.6% of their GDP. And the trade imbalance is ridiculous. Who would do business like this? They're going to make a deal.
So why are they promoting that there is a trade uncertainty?
Because they don't want to talk about what's really moving the markets.
Which is?
Cheap money, monetary methadone. Gabisha, that's all they're doing. You give them more cheap money, they keep gambling. What keeps an addict going? The drug. What keeps a gambler going? Keep giving the gambler money.
And so economically, what is their drug?
Cheap dough. That's why the markets were going down when we called an economic 9/11 back in September. They were going to raise interest rates 3 to 4 times this year. And then Powell bent over and took it from Trump, the Fed chair, and said, yeah, I think we're going to be patient. We're not going to raise rates.
So for investors looking in, do you think they will hold the line on interest rates?
No. They're going to lower them. It's the 2020 election, man. Trump's in the real estate business. His in-laws, the Kushners, they just bought a couple of $100 million more worth of stuff. They're in the real estate business. They got to keep this market going, man. They raised interest rates 9 times since 2015. Let's bring them back another 9. They're going to keep pumping more monetary methadone into the system to keep juicing the markets. So we changed our economic 9/11. It's not going to happen like we said because they backtracked. That's why nobody could predict the future. Mm-hmm. They're wild cards. And Trump card is one of the wildest cards you could get.
But for your listeners then, expect interest rates to come down.
They're going to lower. If the economy slows down, the markets slow down, interest rates come down. And that goes back to gold. Gold today, it's down a little bit. Gold has to, I've been saying this now for years. The downside risk is 1,200. It's around 1,320. It has to break over 1,385 to go to the 1,450 mark. When gold hits 1,450, it skyrockets to 2,000. I've been saying this for 6 years. It hasn't broken over 1,450. On the oil front, very important because what's going on in Venezuela, what's going on in Iran, the Middle East, Saudi Arabia needs oil at $100 a barrel for their economy to break even, their budget. It's down now around 66 bucks.
How long can it stay down?
It was down a lot lower than that. So now it's coming back up. Trump came out a couple of days ago, tweeted, we don't want higher oil, do something about it, because he knows the higher oil prices go. So if there's war in the Middle East, if there's war in Venezuela, if a wild card, man-made or made by Mother Nature, is played, and again, I have to be proper, if it's woman-made or made by Father Nature, a wild card, anything goes. And I'm saying that because there's a $250 trillion debt bubble. The market is a total fraud. The economies are a total fraud. So all it needs is a wild card, a black swan event. Boom, everything crashes. And that's why, and I don't give financial advice, gold is a safe haven asset.
Okay. Gerald, speaking of Venezuela, every news item I read talks about a rigged election, an illegitimate president. What exactly is going on down there?
It's a coup. It's an American-led coup. And to anybody that to believe what's going on, when you hear a Pompeo, when you hear a Bolton, when you hear a Pence, and you hear a Trump, and you hear the Democrats saying, we're bringing democracy to Venezuela. How many times have you heard this story? We're going to bring it to Iraq. No, I say let's bring it to Libya. Well, I think Assad has to go. I don't like the way he's treating his people, I tell you. So, you think it's about the oil. As I said, you think we would have invaded Iraq and Libya if their major crop was broccoli? You were sitting on the world's largest oil reserves. And they got all this baloney. We're bringing in humanitarian aid. Hey, Katsun, you're putting all these sanctions on them, beginning with Obama and others, and more under Trump. You're creating economic warfare against the people. And now you're going to throw them some crumbs? Or maybe some Cheerios?
Well, let's get back to the current president, who's Nicolas Maduro, general. And
he's not a general.
He's not a general.
You see that guy?
That's what the news media says.
You got him. You see, you got him already. This cat man, he's already been brainwashed.
So what is he?
He was a bus driver.
Ralph Cramden? What are we talking about?
You got
here? Ralph Cramden's running Venezuela.
Ralph Cramden. Hey, well, who would you rather have, Ralph Cramden or Penis Cheney? I got to be proper. I don't want to call him Dick.
Okay. But let's go back, because every
little... But you see, you called him a general.
Right.
He was duly elected. The other people didn't go. Matter of fact, when you look at the votes that he got more votes from the population, percentage-wise, than Trump got.
So why is all the media following the story that he's illegitimately elected?
Because they're a bunch of low-life son of a bitches who've been doing this since the beginning of my life. How about the New York Times, the toilet paper record? That Saddam Hussein got them aluminum tubes and he's making that yellow cake. Remember that
Absolutely.
One? One little lying. That's why I call them prostitutes. They get paid to put out by their corporate johns and their Washington whoremasters. And the corporate johns we're talking about, oh, and I got to be proper, and Jills, because they just brought Nikki Haley, our former UN ambassador. Now she's on the board of Boeing. Boeing gone, yep. So going back to this, they're selling out for the military-industrial complex.
So these are business, you're saying this is American primarily business interest looking for oil, and that this is a rigged story?
Total. You heard Bolton saying right out, it's in our Trends Journal, word for word. We're going to bring American oil companies. It would be great if we brought American oil companies in there, and it would be great for the American people. He says it. Hey, how about what's going on in Yemen? How come that's not news? Hey, how about what's going on in the Congo? They had an election, totally fraud. Hey, how about Sudan? Matter of fact, got a little Sudan here. Sudan later. Here we are. President declares year-long emergency. President Omar el-Bashir declared a state of emergency for a year and disbanded the government amid deadly protests. How come that? Look at this tiny little nothing ad story. Who the hell knows what's going on in Sudan, and who gives a shit? I'll tell you who gives a shit. It's South Sudan. They got oil. Maybe we should get involved.
When I got suspicious was when I saw the name Elliot Abrams, who was Trump picked as the person to deal with Venezuela. Remind our listeners who Elliot Abrams is. This guy's a Rhodes Scholar.
He's a Rhodes Scholar. He's also a criminal. And he was given a pardon. Pardon me for my criminal acts. I know the president, and I got a free ride. Yeah, he was the Iran-Contra scandal. He was supporting the dictatorships of South America that were murdering people. This guy's a crazy, murderous neocon. By his record, I'm not just calling him a name. You call a spade a spade. Oh, and I can say that now, and I don't have to be called racist now that Obama's not in anymore.
All right, so give us the trend now. Obviously, this is a big story. Do you predict that the U.S. will invade Venezuela?
I think the United States is already in there, and they're putting together paramilitary groups, and they are going to be behind the overthrow or the assassination of
Maduro.
Now, as Trends Journal subscribers know, history before it happens. Hey, go back to your November Trends Journal. Triangle of Death. We forecast this was going to happen. I said Colombia, Brazil, when they elected Bolsonaro, that's the guy that was the former military guy, mm-hmm. El Capitano, who loved the dictatorship of Brazil. That's the guy they elected. When they elected him, and they also have a right-wing guy over there in Colombia, the triangle of death, I said, is going to be formed at Venezuela, and the United States will be behind the coup. It's right there, black and white. You can see this coming if you're studying the current events forming future trends and not buying into the propaganda by the mainstream media.
Well, we should remind our listeners that for more information about the Trends Journal, they can go to the website trendsjournal.com. Highly recommended.
And they should recommend it to their friends, because we are one of the last standing magazines of real journalism. There's no advertisements in it. We don't get paid off by anybody.
All right, let's go to our second subject. And again, it's one that's been covered in great detail in the Trends Journal. It's one that I think is really important. I do a radio show out of Woodstock, so it's right up Woodstock's alley, and that is the trend, get healthy, get high. You write in the Trends Journal, 2019 is the year legal marijuana goes mainstream. Get us up to date.
1933, they just lifted prohibition. You want to get in the alcohol business?
Good idea.
This is bigger. Why did they lift prohibition? The Great Depression, they needed the tax money. You got this little cazzone over here, Cuomo, in New York. Go back last 2017, March. I'm not gonna legalize marijuana because it's a gateway drug. And if you believe my bullshit, then you'll probably elect me to another term of governor. What adult would say something that it's a gateway drug? If it was a gateway drug, 99% of the people I know would be heroin addicts by now, you know? Save your bullshit. Now, he's all for it.
What changed his mind?
Tax money, need that tax money, need to rip off every goddamn penny I could steal from you so I can be your boss. Hey, the criminals that criminalized it are now legalizing it? I want my cut. I want my cut. I'm gonna tell you how to do this. I'm gonna send up my own divisions over here, and we're gonna tell you what you could do with God's plant.
All right, let's talk about some of the facts now. We have a 2018 farm bill. Why is that important for marijuana?
Oh, because of the legalization of hemp. Again, could you imagine these assholes? They criminalized hemp. And by the way, we have one of the top experts. We will put our expert up against any expert, anywhere, any place, anyhow, anywhere in the world. Matter of fact, they just called him down to Colombia and he just came back. And that's Bradford Beckerman. Our authority, our cannabis authority, who knows all the medical details, ins and outs, sideways, backwards, and forwards, and he's also in the business of cannabis. And that's what it is. Every country calls it cannabis. Only the little low-life scum politicians call it marijuana. It's all cannabis.
All right, well, let's talk about some of the
But I
assets.
Just want to make sure the assets on it, it's going to be a $1 trillion business.
Trillion,
and it's going to go worldwide. Because the medical advantages of this, and once they start coming out more and more, as I keep saying, if the planet could feed us, could it heal us?
Well, we know, I've talked to medical marijuana nurses, for example, who say it is the most miraculous drug you could put in hospitals. It's good with nausea, it's good for insomnia, it's good for anxiety, it's good for chronic pain, and it's safer than opiates. And as you pointed out in the Trends Journal, the United States is totally addicted to opiates. And here's a plant that is not addictive that might even be more effective for a lot of things they're using opiates for. The question is, how fast will this happen if the pharmaceutical companies can't get their greedy mitts into it?
They're going to do is they're going to control it by the government controlling it. So they could, only the bigs are only, most of the bigs will be in the business because the taxes, the regulations are going to be so restrictive for the average person that's going to make it harder for the on-trendpreneur to capitalize on it. So they're going to make it more and more difficult. It's just like how many big companies distribute alcohol?
Mm-hmm. Very few.
Very few. So they're going to make it more restrictive. So they, morons, imbeciles call it campaign contributions. Adults call it bribes and payoffs. Yeah.
But let me go back to your analogy with alcohol, because here in the Mid-Hudson Valley, where we're broadcasting from, there is a wonderful trend of local distilleries putting out really good whiskeys and vodkas and booze, and the ones that are sharp and good marketers are making money.
Yeah.
So is it not possible for an on-trendpreneur to get into the marijuana business and succeed even with the big ones coming in?
Again, they're going to make the regulations so difficult for so many people to be able to afford to get into the business. When they put all the licensing fees and on, they're going to make it really, really hard.
If someone...
Yes, but it's up to the people to change it. This thing shouldn't be regulated at all. You know, they're doing it in Jersey over there. You know what they're putting a tax on it? $42 an ounce. $42 an ounce. And you can't grow it.
Well, let's
I got some little shithead saying you can't grow it. Who the hell are you, you low-life son of a bitch? Oh, got to be equal. Bastard.
Now, let's go globally. I know it's a lot more liberal. First of all, Canada passed an act where it's legal throughout the whole country. Obviously, in the Netherlands and a few other countries, it's much liberal. What about global?
It's going to go global. It's going to go global. They all need the money. It's going to go global. That's why we're saying it's going to be a $1 trillion business and the benefits of it as well.
So right now we have 33 U.S. states that have approved it for medical reasons, 10 states have approved it for recreational reasons. And what do you see as the future of hemp replacing synthetic materials?
Huge.
Don't hear about
now,
that.
Now that's where the entrepreneur could get into there. You know, I was in Nepal, and you see hemp everywhere, hemp bags, hemp clothing. Hemp. So that's going to become a very big trend.
So let's get to our third subject, and we call this our wild card segment because I'm going to pick a subject, and my intention is to help listeners get inside your head a little bit as to who you are and how you do your trends. And I want to start with a phrase that you're the only one I've ever heard use. You refer to yourself as a political atheist. What exactly does that mean?
How could any human being, again, with a half a brain, align themselves with a political party? You lock yourself into a tiny little group of thinking, and you follow the orders of what all the other ones are thinking or saying. I like Obama. Don't say anything bad about Obama. Hey, how about his wars in Libya? How about Assad has to go, don't you say anything bad about Obama. I hate Trump. I hate Trump. And then you hear from the Trump people. I mean, how could anybody defend these freaks? How about by your deeds you shall know them? How about treating a politician like you would treat a family friend, a family member or a friend? Well, if they screw you, screw them.
Forget family. They should be treated as employers because we're hiring them.
They're public servants.
Yeah.
So I'm a political atheist. I was not put on this earth to take orders from assholes. And that's all they are. These people never work a day in their lives, lifetime politicians, telling us what to do. How could any thinking adult believe a Lindsey Graham, a Mitch McConnell, a Nancy Pelosi, a Feinstein, a Schumer, or some other stupid bitch or bastard that's running and ruling your life from the local level up to, hey, I'm the president, and I don't like what this guy over there, this Assad's doing, so I'm going to take your money and send missiles in to blow the shit out of anybody I want, and bomb the hell out of the place because I'm the president of the United States, or some other sick person in another country doing the same thing. How could people with an ounce of morality support these murderous people?
So I'm curious how you came to this. You once worked within the political system. Didn't you work for the New York State Senate?
I'll show you the photo sometime. I was the assistant to the secretary of the New York State Senate at 23 years old.
23?
Yeah. I was the number two guy running the mayoral campaign in Yonkers, New York, city of 300,000 people.
So at what point, because obviously then you were interested in getting in politics, I'm guessing you were idealistic and thought you could make changes?
No, I didn't think of that at all. All I wanted to do was make money and get power and move forward and get into the system and try to do whatever I could to make more dough.
So what did you see in the system that turned you into a political atheist?
I became the government affairs specialist for part of the chemical industry. I used to kill environmental legislation.
Oh, that's quite a history.
Yeah. I was living between Chicago and D.C. And I was 28 years old. I was staying at the Willard Hotel and putting my meetings on at the Hay Adams. I have a picture of me and Ronald Reagan over there. I hired him in 1976 to speak to our group.
Mm-hmm.
That's a whole long story. I'll tell you another time. I was with him for an hour and a half. In those days, you picked him up at the Chicago Hilton. We had our convention over at McCormick Place. And they didn't have cars or all this stuff. I mean, there's 2 days before he's announcing he's running for president against Gerry Ford. I picked him up at the top floor of the Chicago Hilton, and we got in a cab. Me, him, and Mike Diva, and went to McCormick Place. It wasn't a big deal. I put on a brunch with him and our board of directors.
Diva became his right-hand man in the White House.
Oh, yeah, he's one of the right-hand men, yeah. I stayed in contact with Diva in later years, too. Anyway, late 1970s, I think it was 78 or 70, 78 or 77, I think it was 78. The Iranian crisis is breaking out. And I knew about how the CIA and the MI6 overthrew the democratically elected government of Mossadegh in 1953. Kermit Roosevelt.
To install the Shah.
To bring down the Shah. Because the infamous Kermit Roosevelt was Teddy Roosevelt's grandson, the head of the CIA there. In June of 2017, finally came out with a report. We, the stupid little moron little people, are not allowed to read what they wrote about what was going on and the dirty deeds that they were committing until like about 60 years later, or whatever. So they finally came out with the documents. There's Winston Churchill saying that we need the Iranian energy, the Iranian oil. It's there in black and white. It was called Anglo-Iranian oil before Mossadegh came in.
Mm-hmm.
He nationalized the oil fields. Goes back to your first question about Venezuela.
Right, we're right.
What
back
do you think it was
again.
About? He had the nerve to say it wasn't Anglo-Iranian oil, better known today as BP, or Standard Oil, better known today as ExxonMobil. It's we the people of Iran's oil. Nah, it's our oil.
Right.
So they overthrew Mossadegh, brutal. They put in the Savak, the secret police. They were renowned for being a little bit more brutal than the SS. When the revolution started to happen, and I'm seeing millions of people out in the street, I said, oh, this thing is real. Jimmy Carter comes back from Iran after spending New Year's Eve with the Shah and his wife. Him and Rosalind went there. And announces to the American people in the world that the Shah is the island of stability in the Middle East. Quote. It's a quote. As we used to say in the Bronx, bullshit has its own sound. As this cat's going down, man. So what I started to do was buy gold and oil futures. That's how I got into the trends business, and that's when I became a political atheist. The whole nation bought the lie of Iran. They're still buying it today.
They bought it in Iraq, and now you're saying they're buying it in Venezuela.
And they're buying it in Venezuela. So that's how I became a political atheist. And again, that's how I also got in the trends business, because then by that time in my life, I was about 32 when I left, I didn't want to keep killing environmental legislation. And I didn't like what I was doing anymore. I started to grow up more. And I made enough money from trading gold and oil futures. My first buy of gold was $187.50 an ounce.
Well, this is a good start. And we're talking about starting Trend Vision 2020. We look forward to coming back tomorrow. We encourage you to go to the Trends Journal website, trendsjournal.com, and join us for the next episode of Trend Vision 2020.